I'm sure you all heard a lot about behavioral science, and this is a subject that's like bandied about a lot. So what I'm going to do today is talk a little bit about what behavioral science is about, what the subject actually does, and how does that fit into the organization, especially a tech product or organization space. And this, whatever I picked up from my experience, and maybe a few examples of the kind of things that we've been doing at Grab. So to start off with, who am I and what is my role? And I always keep joking about this, that at Grab, my role is probably the most mysterious one, because I've never got away from a conversation without someone asking me, what exactly do you do? So I decided to create a Venn diagram out of that. So my role is at intersections of a lot of things. So what I do is a little bit of psychology, a little bit of business and economics, and a little bit of design and marketing. So at the middle of all of that is the role of behavioral science. And it sort of is like a supporting role to various other functions. And our job is basically to understand human behavior. So why do we even need this subject? Why are people talking about it so much? Why do product organizations need to care so much about behavioral science? So let me actually put that in another way. Who has actually said this? Yes, I would willingly pay 20 times more for a coffee that I can make at home for 40 cents. Nobody ever said that. And yet you'll see people queuing up for Starbucks. How about this? Who has said, yes, I think a coarse, uncomfortable fabric which takes ages to dry and fades unpleasantly is exactly what I want to wear every day. Nobody ever said it. And the irony hits me so hard because I'm wearing jeans right now. But we all wear jeans, right? If you had actually done user research on this and had asked people about it, very few people would have said that this is what they wanted. So why are people like this? Why do people say something, do something? And this is a quote actually that sums it up really well. Consumers don't think how they feel. They don't say what they think. And they don't do what they say. Who said that? Somebody actually did say that. So David Ogilvy said that. And he is an maverick advertiser who has created some amazing ads over the years. And we've all learned a lot from him. But this particular statement that he said in all his wisdom is actually one of the most important things that all of us should know about. That people actually don't know most of the times how they are feeling. And a lot of times when we assume things about how customers will feel about a certain product or an experience, what we actually hear from them is not exactly what they're thinking. Which is why it's important to actually peel those layers and really understand what are these hidden forces that shape our decisions. Yes, we are not rational all the time, but we're also irrational in some predictable ways. And that's what behavioral science is all about. It's about, instead of just depending on logic for everything, how do you use psychology and try and understand why are people doing what they're doing? So how do we actually do that? Some of this might be things that you already know, but because this is a 101, so I'm going to still give you a little standard spiel about what exactly behavioral science is about. So we try and understand how people really think. To start off, maybe we could do like a very simple exercise, and you could do it at your own end. It's, and you must have seen this before, it's called the Stroop test. So you basically have to name the color in which the word is written. And you don't say the word, you say the color in which the word is written. Fairly simple, right? Then it gets a little more complicated because you start thinking about something and saying something else. Again, easy, but then again starts getting complicated. So you can see that there is a struggle that's happening there, right? You want to say something, like in this row, you want to say red because it's written red, but you have to force yourself to say blue. So what's actually happening there defines this whole subject. And the basic principle behind that is that our brain has two systems. So there's system one, which is the unconscious, intuitive side of our brain. So this is the side that takes a lot of everyday decisions. So if I ask you what's 10 into 5, you don't have to think about it. You know the answer to it. So these are things that come naturally to you. And then there is the system two side of our brain, which is the more conscious, rational, reflective side. So if I asked you a complicated math question like 317 into 26, you will take your time to answer that. This side is complex, but it's also more reliable. But the thing is, as Kahneman says it, thinking to humans is like swimming to cats. They can do it, but they would rather not do it. So most of the time, what happens is system one takes lead in our decision making, which means system two is generally just following along. And unless required, it doesn't kick in. which actually makes sense. If you go about in your day-to-day life analyzing every single decision you had to make, it will make things really hard, which is why system one is there to help you navigate through some of the complexity in this world. And it does that by using a lot of shortcuts and things that we'll talk about later. The catch is that a majority of our decisions are actually made by system one, which means that a lot of our decisions in our day-to-day life are actually not made by the rational brain. And again, that's okay because you don't have to use your rational brain for everything. But the problem with that is when we do public policy, when we do marketing, when we do product development, when we do advertising, when we do HR, for everything, we always assume that the consumers are rational. I made a product with XYZ product flow, and people are going to follow this because that's the logical flow. But people are not thinking like that because a lot of times they're just depending on their intuition and they're using shortcuts to come to decisions. So they're probably not using the rational side of their brain as much while using a product as you think they are. What behavioral science does is it deals with understanding how system one actually thinks and how you can actually use that knowledge to make better informed policies, better marketing, better products, better HR policies, etc. So how does system one think? I kept saying it uses shortcuts, but what it actually does is literally this. You know that there is a certain path to be taken to come to a decision, but because you don't have all the time in the world to go through that actual path, you use a lot of shortcuts. These shortcuts are also called heuristics. So for example, if I asked you something as simple as Jack's height is 6'2", so his favorite sport is, and I always keep a track of this question because I think this is the 29th time I'm asking this question, and 100% of times I've got the answer basketball. So that's a representativeness heuristic that you used. You thought Jack is tall, so he probably likes basketball because tall people like basketball. But he could be liking chess, right? He could be liking soccer. He could be liking cricket. He could like anything. But because our brain had to use a shortcut within the constraints of the given information that it has, it came to the conclusion that it makes sense to say basketball is probably his favorite sport. So that's a heuristic or a shortcut that your brain used. When I ask you what color comes to mind when I say Coke, most people would say either red or they'll say black. And it's not by coincidence, right? It's a association that the brand has allowed you to make consistently by showing that in their branding. So that's again a shortcut that your brain used. Because I've seen Coke with red, when somebody says Coke, the color red comes to mind. How about something like this? If there are two sentences written, one in large font, one in really small font, which is the one which you'll actually read? It'll obviously be the one with the larger font, right? And the funny thing about this is, even when we do product, when we do advertising, in all of that, this matters so much, right? People are mostly ignoring the fine print, or they're not reading most of the text that you're saying because there's no cognitive ease in it. Wherever there's cognitive ease, they'll go through that easily because the brain is just trying to find a shortcut and do something fast, which is why it actually uses that kind of a shortcut. So there are a lot of terms that are thrown around all the time. So I thought I'll also use this opportunity to actually clear that up a little bit. So I said heuristic and shortcut. So heuristic is basically all these shortcuts that you're using. The most common example of a heuristic is actually catching a ball. So when you know that a ball is being thrown towards you, you don't do that whole physics of projectile motion to calculate where to angle your hand so that the ball falls there, right? Your brain uses some kind of a heuristic or a shortcut to place your hand there. So that's actually a heuristic. A bias is when a heuristic sometimes points you in the wrong direction or in a consistent direction, which is what happened with Jack and the basketball answer, right? When the answer was being pointed towards a certain direction, it starts becoming a bias. And an error is actually something very random. So let me actually show that to you with exactly how it looks. So if you had a dartboard and I'd ask you the question, Jack's height is 6'3", what is his favorite sport? Somebody said chess, somebody said basketball, somebody said soccer. That's hitting random darts here and there on the board. But when I said Jack's height is 6'2", what's his favorite sport? And everybody says basketball. That means you know everybody's using the same shortcut. So everybody's hitting in the same direction, but it's the wrong direction. So basically, error is something random, but a bias is actually a systematic error. It happens because of a similar shortcut that everybody's using. The thing about a bias is it can be corrected. So if you know people are shooting the right way but in the wrong direction, you can do two things. Either you move their hand to the right or you move the dartboard to the left. And that's what nudging is all about. So a simple example of that is if somebody wants people to pick more healthy fruits and vegetables in the supermarket, you know that people will, you know that people generally pick from eye level shelves. So you replace snacks there and you put fruits and vegetables. So people keep taking stuff from eye level, but now instead of snacks, they're picking more fruits and vegetables. This was actually done as an experiment in the UK by the government when they wanted people to eat healthier. So you can see that bias comes with knowing about people's biases gives you the advantage of knowing what to do about it. You can actually nudge people in a certain direction. The problem with all of this knowledge is that there are, if you go online, it's almost like too much information. If you go online and you search, you'll see lots of things about biases there. You'll see this cognitive bias index with 150 biases, and that number keeps going up every time I read about it. So there are a lot of biases out there. So how would you actually know what biases to look out for when you're designing your products or you're doing your marketing? So I generally teach this framework in most of my workshops because I think this sort of covers a large part of our behavior. So the first part of that is it's basically ABCD. So it starts with attention, then it goes on to belief, then choices and determination. So I'll cover like a single bias in each of this so that it becomes easier for you to imagine what I'm saying. So A is when we're talking about attention. I'll also pause here for a second in case there are any questions on the chat. Okay, so Aditya asked, is a bias always negative? Not necessarily, but a bias has the chances of going in the negative direction if you're not considering all the information. A similar question also asked by Anoop is, Jack and basketball is not really negative. Completely agree on that. I think the thing is, what a bias is doing is, a heuristic actually helps you in most cases, which is why it's not wrong that we use all of these shortcuts. There's nothing wrong with it. It's just that there are times when you might be misled towards the wrong direction because of that. If I was Jack and I was 6'2 and I never played basketball, I would find this stereotyping that I'm tall, just because I'm tall, you think I play basketball. And we know from our world around now that there is a lot of unconscious bias that has been built into us. And when that happens, I think sometimes it's very helpful to us, but a lot of times it may or may not be helpful. So knowing about it, and especially from like a product designer, product manager, or a marketing person's perspective, this information is important to have, like irrespective of whether a bias is good or bad, this information is important to have because when you're designing, you would know what you need to do to either correct the bias or nudge people towards a direction that they need to go to. Is it considered a bias if people choose junk over fresh food? No. So there the point was more about that people are doing a certain thing and they are used to a certain process because of a habit, and you are just using that system to get them to do something else. So that was a typical example of moving the dartboard a little to the right so that people keep doing what they're doing and they don't have to. So if you told people that at every point in the supermarket, if they have to evaluate which is better, fresh food or junk food, that's something that they don't want to do, which is why they pick whatever is easily available to them. Which is why it's important for us to, so if we know that this particular behavior of taking more fresh food is good for them, and you know that people are looking at whatever is visible to them, you are just replacing that and putting fresh food over there so that they keep doing what they're doing. They don't have to use a lot of information to change their behavior, but you're still getting them to change a behavior towards something that you consider to be good. Is bias the same as a mental model? Not completely. Sorry, somebody asked a question. Sorry, I can't hear you, whoever this is.
Hello?
Yeah,
I think he's on mute. Let me unmute. Do you mind type your question in the chat box? Customer experience lab.
So I'll just move on to the next question that's here. Is a bias same as a mental model? Not completely. A mental model may or may not be a bias, because a mental model is more about how people are thinking about things in a certain context. That's a little different from a bias. A bias is more of a shortcut that has been formed over years of learning, and then you keep using that. A mental model is more about a lens or a perspective that you're using to view a certain transaction or a certain context. Can bias be construed as herd mentality? No, not necessarily. And I'll cover some bit of it later in the presentation as well. A bias is more from like a single person's perspective, but I'll cover some part of herd mentality later. A couple of people asked about bias versus gut. The question says, there are three or four people who have asked about bias versus gut. Sandeep here says, bias is something when an action is taken without much thought, whereas gut or model is a deliberate decision. I'm not sure if that's the right definition, but bias is, maybe I should have been clearer about what I was saying with when I said bias. I think the thing about a bias is that it may or may not be wrong. I'm not saying it is necessarily wrong, but it's just that sometimes all of these shortcuts that our brain have formed, like 5 into 10 is equal to 50, is a shortcut that your brain has formed, and it helps you most of the time. So it's not a bad thing. But suppose under certain circumstances, it turns out to be the wrong answer because your brain is just using that shortcut and not considering the rest of the context in it, then it starts becoming something wrong. And I'll show you some examples of that later in the presentation. Maybe that will make it a little more clearer. Yeah. So I'll Thank move you. On here. I'll just move on from here. So the framework I was referring to was basically A, B, C, and D. And we'll start out with A, that's attention. I think one of the biggest problems that most of us as product owners or marketing owners face is we assume that everybody is always paying attention to us all the time. But we know that that's not true, right? I mean, so many things just slip out of our radar. And this is not even thinking as consumers. Just think about yourself. The number of times you've made a to-do list and yet things fall off our radar and we forgot to do so many things, right? You forget to take medicine sometime. You forget to go to the gym. And there are so many things that need our attention that we actually don't have unlimited attention. So when that happens, we should know that people are going to be attention deficit. And we should know that because there are so many things around us where we see this happening, right? And consider something as simple as this, where a doctor has to look at a scan like this all the time. And they're so busy looking for a tumor on this that most of them actually miss out this image of a gorilla that has been pasted there. And this has been tested out so many times with so many doctors. And it's because they're looking for a specific shape and they're so focused on that shape that something so out of the ordinary that is still there, it actually completely misses their attention, right? So you know that when it comes to attention, we don't have like 100% attention all the time, and nor do your consumers. And when we know that, we should also know that people are only going to look at whatever is visible to them, and they will make their decisions in that context. So if you want people to pay attention to things, then you will have to think of ways in which you can actually solve for this attention deficit. And there are multiple ways you can do that. So salience is one of them. Now this seems like something very common where you have footsteps towards bins. But when it was first done, it led to some 46% reduction in litter in Copenhagen where it was first tried out. The thing is, if you went and asked people again, why did you throw litter in the bin? Nobody will tell you that they did it because they saw the footsteps pointing towards that. But you know that that was actually the reason why that happened, right? So when you know that people are going to be attention, they're going to be lacking attention towards your products all the time, and you want people to still change their behavior, what can you do to actually increase salience and push them towards that direction, so that even if consciously they're not looking at doing that behavior which you want them to do, unconsciously they still do it because of the salience of the markers towards it. Other popular ways, one of them is reminders, and I'm sure you would have seen Duolingo's passive aggressive reminders, where they tell you all the time and they keep reminding you about doing your lessons. So reminders work. Why? Because you know that people, even if people have signed up for something, you know that people will not remember doing it. So reminders' job is basically getting back that attention, fighting for that attention space from your customers. Then there are prompts. I'm sure you've seen this in Gmail, where it reminds you to reply to a certain mail or follow up on a certain mail. So all of these are things where the product managers have understood that people have a problem with attention and that you need to do something to get them to think more actively about your product. And then there are defaults. When you know that people, so one of the things with defaults is that people will, very few people will actually remember to sign out of, to opt out of defaults, which is why a lot of companies take advantage of that. And I will cover the ethics of this later, but I'm sure you would have had these cases where you subscribe to something and then it takes the rest of your life to subscribe out of it because they realize that you will not opt out of it. So you just got opted into it. So there are positives and negatives to it, but where what they did there was they actually took advantage of your attention deficit and said, this person is not paying attention, so let me take advantage of that and opt them into something. There are some places where that's very good, but there are some places where that's not bad, and we'll cover that in the ethics later. The second part of this model is to think about belief. Again, in all our wisdom, we think that people are always forming their beliefs, taking into account all possible information. But we know that's not true, right? Because think of the number of times you've gone on Google to search for something and you clicked on the very first link that agreed with exactly what you thought, commonly known as confirmation bias. But that's something that all of us have been through, right? A lot of times we don't form our belief on the basis of rational information, but we form it on the basis of certain contexts and certain things that have been put forward to us. For example, this is probably one of the most famous examples of this particular bias. A bunch of students are randomly selected and asked to write down the last two digits of their social security number. And then they're asked how much they would pay to watch Jerry Seinfeld live on campus. You would think that these two numbers are completely unrelated, but they're not. The higher your social security number, the more people are willing to pay to watch Seinfeld. What is the relation? Absolutely nothing. What actually happens there is the if you were independently asked how much would you pay to watch Seinfeld on campus, people would have to think, right? There is a lot of rational thinking you have to do. You have to think, how much would I have paid for another artist? Or what was the last time I paid for a comedian? How much did that cost? If there's inflation, what would it cost today? How much would I pay for a musician? How much would I pay for a rock concert? I mean, there are so many things you would have to think about reference pricing to come to a conclusion about how much to pay to watch Seinfeld. But what they did with this question is when they asked you what's your social security number, you got anchored on the last two digits of the number. And then you suddenly use that as an anchor and think, okay, if it sounds like this might be a rough range with no other idea of any other context, that it's possible that you got impacted by that and you thought that unrelated thing still makes sense. So that's actually called anchoring, where you form a belief with, especially with numbers, you form a belief which may or may not be related, but still ends up anchoring you to a certain thing. The most classiest example of this is actually what was done by De Beers many, many years ago. So what De Beers did right after the World War was they wanted men to buy engagement rings for women. So this whole thing about engagement rings is now like a very common thing, but back then it wasn't that common. And if you can imagine it, the irony of it, that a diamond company which has always sold rings to, which has always sold jewelry to women, now suddenly wants to convince men to buy rings for women. So obviously they needed to think through what will actually convince men to do this, right? And even from a man's perspective, how much should I spend on a ring? They have no idea and they don't know what will make a woman happy. So What did they do? They came up with this statement that says, how can you make 2 months' salary last forever? The beauty of this is it works at every level. Men are now thinking that they need to spend at least 2 months' salary. Women are now thinking, if a man is not spending 2 months' salary, does he even love me anymore? And the best part about this is you can make it work at any level. My salary can be $1,000. My salary can be $10,000. I can be a millionaire who earns $100,000 per month. Whatever my salary is, I still find 2 months' salary to be a benchmark, and I can easily think about spending that much money on an engagement ring. They actually tried this out in different countries with different numbers. I think the number 3 worked in Japan, where they said, how can you make 3 months' salary last forever? So that actually shows you that people are always looking for anchors. What's a good number that can explain me this decision, and then I can think about it without putting too much effort in it. So DBS actually did that in a very classy way. But there are many other examples of this. For example, this campaign by the UK government, which says eat 5 a day for better health. This is about fruits and vegetables. Who came up with the number 5? I'm sure there are scientific reasonings behind it. But more importantly, that number could have been 6, that could have been 7, that could have been 15. But they chose a number that is easy to get anchored to. And because of that, when you go to a supermarket, people are thinking, okay, I have to buy 5 types of fruits and vegetables. So you basically anchored them to the number 5. Similarly, this by a mattress company that says, we'll remind you to replace your mattress every 8 years. Who picked the number 8? The company decided to do it. And because they did it, now people are all thinking that, okay, 8 years is what I need to keep in mind to replace my mattress. So they anchored you to the number 8. And this is probably the most common application. You must have seen this all over e-commerce, where they show you an original price and they slash it and they put a lower price beside it. And the reason they do that is because they want you to get to a higher, to get anchored to a higher price. And then the lower price beside it starts looking better because your reference price has now been set. Because people are always looking for these numbers or looking for references, what all of these campaigns do is basically set you up for a reference so that you can use that, and you can use that to get anchored to something. The third part of the framework is about choice. Again, we are not chess players, but we assume that everybody is always in a chess player mode. We're always thinking about our next move. If I have to choose something from a menu, I'm going to look at all options and I'm going to consider the pros and cons of everything and choose. For anything that I do, I'm always going to look at all possible ramifications of it and then decide. But we know that's not true, right? Most of the decisions we make in our day-to-day life are actually pretty much run by context. Everything is dependent on what the environment is presenting to us. And there are multiple ways where we have seen this happen. I'll show you a couple of them, but I'm sure you would relate to some of these. Somebody had mentioned the herd mentality thing earlier. So this is also a very famous experiment by Cialdini, where what he wanted to do was, in hotels, you want people to reuse their towels because it's good for the environment. How good do you think it is to tell people that do something because it's good for the environment? A lot of people don't do it. So they tried out this experiment with 3 different types of labels. On the first one, they say, you should do this because it's good for the environment. So please reuse the towels. The second one says, join your fellow guests in helping save the environment. 75% of guests in this hotel have reused their towels. And the third one says, 75% of guests who stayed in this room 321 reuse their towels. So what were they trying to do? They were basically trying to see which appeal would be most effective. And this is what they saw. They saw that the third label, where you say 75% of guests who stayed in this particular room 321 reuse their towels, that had the highest, those rooms had the highest reuse rates. And of course, the one with the general norm around the hotel also had high rates. The important thing over here is that people like doing what others are doing. That's what social proof is. That's what herd mentality is, where you're always looking for clues from others. If I have to make a choice, I'm okay doing what others are doing because I assume that a group of people making an aggregate choice is probably the right thing. I would always choose a restaurant with a long queue because if it has a long queue, it must be a good restaurant because there are so many people standing there. But what is even more interesting about this particular experiment is you don't just want to do what others are doing, but you specifically want to do what others like you are doing. What is the relationship between you and a previous person who stayed in room number 321? Absolutely nothing. But you still want to do what that person did because You feel like you belong to the same group, and if that person stayed here and did that, it makes sense for me to do that as well. So that is actually an even more important part of social proof. And there are a lot of examples of this you would have seen around. I've put some here. So for example, this is one where Costa Coffee's ad where it says 7 out of 10 coffee lovers prefer Costa. He could have just said 7 out of 10 people prefer Costa. But then that doesn't put you in a group of coffee lovers. If you're a coffee lover, you're immediately thinking, okay, other coffee lovers like me prefer Costa, so it must be the right place to go to. So that is actually where they've used not just a social norm, but a very specific social norm that relates you to a certain group that you want to be associated with. Similarly, when Amazon tells you customers who bought this item also bought these items, they're also doing the same thing, that people, it's not just that people are generally buying these items, but people who bought this particular item specifically buy these items too. Same thing for Airbnb telling you that people who looked at this place are also looking at this particular place. The more generic social norm is something like this, which is what subscriptions do. And this is something that you'll see in most subscriptions, including earlier on Grab, where it shows you one popular plan because they want to tell you that that's the social norm and that's the one that most people are picking. I also put a picture of the iPod here because, interestingly, Jonathan Ivey, who was one of the designers for the iPod, always credits one particular thing for increasing the sales of the iPod initially, and that was actually the white earphones. So he used to say that one of the reasons why this product became so popular was because no other company had white earphones at the time, and every time you would see somebody with white earphones in a public transport or when you're going somewhere and you see it, you suddenly become related to that group, that okay, this person also has white earphones, so he belongs to this group of people who own the iPod. And apparently that was one of the biggest reasons why this became so viral, because everybody wanted to be a part of that group which owned these white earphones and hence owned an iPod. So there was certain kind of signaling that you were doing with by owning that particular product. Other ways in which choice gets impacted by our context is actually things like the decoy effect, where you have certain options that are put in front of you in certain ways so that you pick a particular option. So there are a lot of things in our context that actually keep influencing our choice. And the last one is determination, where, and all of us know about this, there's nothing new for any of us. If you've signed up for a gym in the beginning of the year and then realize you were not going after Feb, you are a part of a group of most of the world. And most of us fall into this category of people who don't have unlimited determination. We have lives and we have a lot of things to do. So even though we feel like a future self of ourselves will take care of a lot of things, but it doesn't. A lot of times we give a lot of credit to our future self, but it's actually not true. A lot of times we are just living in the present. And there are a lot of examples of that, whether that's gym membership, whether that's diets, whether that's saying that I'll read so many books this year. We know that our determination is not perfect. This particular experiment here is, again, one of the more popular ones about behavioral economics, where they ask a group of people to choose a snack for themselves for a week from now. And you could choose between a healthy snack like an apple or a cake. Most people choose an apple for next week because, you know, your healthier self, next week you're going to be healthy and you'd obviously want the healthy option. But when you have to pick for today, now, what's the snack you want? Most people pick a cake. Because right now, it's okay. I want to indulge myself right now, but my future self will take care of it. So that's actually called the pleasant bias, where you always live in this assumption that your future self is the nicer, more perfect person who will take care of everything. But that future person never comes. And this plays out in a lot of things. The smaller things like gym membership, diets, reading, yes. But also larger things like, why don't people save for retirement? Because you always assume that somebody will take care of it later. So there are all these things where, you know, people always think that they will commit to doing something, but they actually are not able to do it because of many things. The fact that they're stuck in a lot of day-to-day life where they don't have time to think about these things, or that they always assume that if it's not today, then tomorrow person will take care of it. So there are so many things that actually hinder people from doing all these things. So when you are thinking about these, what can you do to actually help people stay the course? So one thing is to help them make personal commitments. This particular clock is called the Shreddy, where you insert a $100 bill and if you keep snoozing, it starts shredding your note. So that's a personal commitment that This is personally one of my favorite examples, because that's a personal commitment you've made that you're going to get up on time. And when you've made a hard commitment like that, what this product basically does is it helps you stick to that particular commitment. This is, of course, a very harsh way of doing it, but there are other ways of doing it. So there's this site called stick.com where you can make a commitment. You can say that I'm putting up $100 and I'll go to the gym every day of this week. If I don't, then I'll lose this money. They made it even more interesting by saying that you won't just lose this money, but you'll lose this money to an anti-charity, which means that this especially works in the US. You can actually choose a charity that you don't believe in. So if you're a Democrat and you don't go to the gym for a week, $100 will go to a Republican trust. So there are ways in which you can make people commit and be more serious about their goals by understanding what is it that actually helps them commit to these things. The second way you can do it, so that was a personal commitment. The second way you can do it is actually through a public commitment. So this is the story of Ulysses, where I'm sure most of you know the story. So Ulysses is in a boat with some people and he's supposed to cross a particular stretch of the ocean, but that stretch has these angels of death who come and sing in a particular way that makes people die. So his men are scared. They don't want to go through that path. So what he does is he pours wax in their ears and he tells them to row, and he promises them, he makes a public commitment to them that tie me to the mast and no matter what, I will listen to the angels of death and I'll make sure that you don't have to listen to it. So they tie him, and because they have wax in their ears, they cannot hear the angels of death, and they go through that part and he suffers a lot, but because he made a public commitment to it, he sticks by his commitment and he gets them through safely. Obviously, this is a very complex case of public commitment. It need not be that complex, but what some of these sites do, like for example, Stick also has this thing where you get to choose somebody as a referee or a host. So you can say that I will go to the gym for the next 7 days and here's $100 and here's this person who I'm making a commitment to. So he will make sure that I'm actually sticking through this, and that sort of becomes like a public commitment for them. So like I was saying earlier, if you go online and look, there'll be like hundreds of biases like this. I just picked four which fit into this framework. But the thing about this framework is also that whatever bias you pick would actually fit into one of these. So next time you go online and you read about any bias, just try and think about which part of this thinking process is it actually affecting. Is it something to do with people's attention bias? Is it something to do with how they're forming their beliefs? Is it, so for example, something like loss aversion? It's about how you're forming your beliefs in the wrong way. If you look at choices, are people making choices in a biased way, or is it about determination? Are people not doing something because of how their determination is giving up on them? So if you just look at what this framework basically does, is it gives you an easy way to analyze any given situation and understand what's actually happening there, and then map it to a bias, which you can then look at either nudging or solving. So how do we actually use this knowledge? So this is all very fancy and nice and sounds very good on paper and in webinars like this, but how do you actually go about using some of this? So generally the process you would use is you would start out by understanding this behavior and analyzing why it's happening. So that's where this framework comes in, and it helps you look at the hidden parts about the behavior. Why are people doing what they're doing? Because of the biases or because of all these things that exist in their natural state. Once you have that, then you can come up with strategies. What can you do to actually nudge people towards the behavior that you want? And then finally, what's the intervention that you want to do and what's the kind of change it will lead to? So I'll give you a couple of examples from here. And I think somebody from my team who actually worked on this is also on the call. If you are there, then a shout out to you. But a simple example of this is, how do we get passengers to cancel less? So this is an interesting case, because in this particular case, what we realized was that people cancel, but specifically there are certain people who were canceling a lot. And these were the people who were canceling despite being given warnings. So they had already been marked out on a list and they were on a blacklist, and they were always being told consistently that you're canceling too many rides, you're canceling too many rides, but nothing actually mattered to them. So when we looked at all this analysis, one of the things that stands out is that people, when they are in the app and their booking rides and their canceling, they're not actually, they don't have a view to what's happening in the rest of the world. It's about them and their own world, and they don't know what's happening outside of it. So in that world, they don't know what the norm is, right? So how many cancels is bad? Is 3 cancels bad? Is 5 cancels bad? Nobody's actually telling them that. So from what they knew, they thought they were doing okay, and they didn't actually need somebody to tell them that. So one of the strategies we had thought of, and we had a bunch of experiments on this where we tried out different strategies. One of them was actually on social norms, where we thought instead of just giving warnings, we'll also add a social norm to it. So we ran this experiment where we sent out these messages with different types of content, and it actually led to lower cancellation rates. And this is what the message looked like. The standard message says, please do not cancel your Grab booking unnecessarily because canceling can be frustrating to the driver. This is a standard message. The one where we added a social norm said, you are receiving this message because you're in the top 1% of people with high cancellation rates. So there you're actually pointing out a social norm and saying that you're doing what most people are not doing. So now a person is more aware that his actions are actually not just him doing this alone in his own environment, but as a part of a larger society. And what he's doing is actually against the social norms. And when we sent out that message, it led to 18% lower cancellation rates. And this actually stayed around for a pretty long time. So we actually rolled this out at a larger scale because we realized that this as a message is a generally more sticky message than just telling people not to cancel. Another example of this is about increasing trust for passengers. Again, I know somebody from the team is here, so shout out to them for this as well. So here, one of the behaviors we started out was, and this was back when I just joined Grab, and we realized that people don't like surge prices. In our own context, it makes a lot of sense. We're doing surge pricing because it helps people get drivers when they really need them. But people actually don't think like that. For most people, they don't like surge prices. And when we actually spoke to more people and understood why they were saying what they're saying, we realized the problem was that people don't like black boxes. Opaque fares which don't have an explanation make it very hard to believe what's actually happening behind the scenes. And when that's happening, it's easy to, if there's a black box, it's easy to blame somebody for it rather than actually go through the process of sorting it and understand what's actually happening behind that black box. So we were stuck in that situation where the only message we were putting out every single time was high fare due to high demand. And if you see that message at 1 o'clock in the night, you know there's no demand. So most people are like, these people are, this is just a black box. They just decide the rates the way they want. It's nothing to do with demand. It's nothing to do with drivers. So then we realized that given that we are actually doing this for a reason, we should be honest and tell people about why the fares are high. So the intervention was we actually created a product which takes into account various signals and use on the basis of all of these things, like for example, time of day, how many drivers are around, which area you are in, what's the surge around that area. So on the basis of all of these signals, it actually tells you one particular reason why the fare is the way it is. And for that, we ran experiments with different kinds of explanations, and that actually led to a higher satisfaction score for our customers. So now when you see on the Grab app, you'll see a message like this that says, for example, in this particular sales, it says, very few drivers in this area, hang on. What we're trying to tell you is not that there are too many people or that high fare due to high demand. We're giving you a specific reason saying that in this particular area, there are very few drivers, and that's the reason why the fare is the way it is. And there were a bunch of messages like this. Like in the middle of the night, you would see a message that says, Batman drivers are out to get you. And that was because we wanted people to know that in the middle of the night, there aren't too many drivers around. And those who are there are actually superheroes because they're the ones who are working when no one else is working. And for that, they deserve a higher fare. And that's why there are very few drivers out there. So what we did was we added this layer of context that made people believe our prices more and understand what's actually happening and why they're paying a higher price. And that actually led to much higher satisfaction scores for us. A third example is from the driver side. So here we had a very typical case in Indonesia specifically. We realized that drivers are very sticky in their regions. So they, and this was two-wheel drivers. So what they do is they tend to hang around in certain regions because they're familiar with that and they don't want to go out of it. So, and if there are no jobs there, they'll just wait around there, but they won't go to another region. And it wasn't because we didn't tell them. We consistently give information to them that there are neighboring areas where there are more jobs. But they just like being sticky and being in their own area. So one of the, when we did the analysis, we realized that one of the problems was that it's sort of like the whole present bias idea, right? I'll choose a chocolate for myself now, but I'll choose an apple for myself later. But the problem with something like that is that people are not actually visualizing the end state. When you can visualize the end state, you're more willing to take actions. If you suddenly tell me that at 8 a.m. tomorrow, go to this particular area because there are more jobs there, like, I'm too busy in my world right now to even think about what, why I should be going there at 8 a.m. And at 8 a.m., I definitely don't remember this. So what we decided to do was we used something called implementation intentions, and I'll show you the example of that. So we asked people what exactly they would be doing and made them visualize that particular hour. And then we ran experiments with multiple explanations like that. So the standard message basically said you can earn more. Drivers in the nearby area have 20% more jobs during this time. But the message in the variant said, what are you doing at 5 p.m. today? Earn more by going to this nearby area. And we realized something as small as that actually made people visualize that particular instant when they actually have to make that move. And when they think about that, what are you doing at 5 p.m. today? And it occurs to them that they would be doing nothing because there aren't enough jobs in their area. Then it strikes them that, okay, going to this nearby area makes more sense. It actually led to a lot of people moving around and going to a place that was sometimes less than a kilometer away, but actually led to higher rides for them. So these are actually some examples of how you can use this framework or generally behavioral science in product, but let me also specifically cover different parts of the product cycle because I know that a lot of people from different parts have joined in here. So there are different ways in which you can use behavioral science. If you're looking at user research, which is the first part and where you're actually doing research early in the product process, it's important for you to use behavioral science because it helps uncover why people do what they do. If you ask people, they'll just tell you what they're doing. But they'll never be able to tell. It's like the garbage bin experiment that I told you about earlier. If you ask people, why are you putting litter in the litter bin now? They'll never tell you it's because of footsteps. So what literature review does is it helps you decipher some of this user research and uncover things about psychological reasons why people are doing what they're doing. For example, when we did the research on search price, we read a lot of literature around how people set reference prices, how they use previous prices and previous experiences to set reference prices. And that actually made us understand a little more about why people were saying that these prices hurt them a lot. The second part is design. So this is something very close to heart because I work a lot with the design teams. With the design team, it's actually multiple places where behavioral science sits very well. The first part is breaking down the user journey from a behavioral lens. So when you do audits of your behavioral journey, it helps you to preempt the fail points. Instead of waiting for a journey to happen and then look at the funnel and realize why people are dropping out at different parts, what you can do is you can actually preempt that with audits and at every fail point, figure out the various reasons why a bias might happen. And because of that, what can you actually do as an intervention and run small experiments on those. One example of this, which we had actually done, was about subscriptions. Because when we had just started our subscriptions, we realized that people could be dropping out because they actually cannot visualize the benefit of a subscription. So we actually modified our flow to fit in with that. Then the third part is data science. Data science is like very important in all tech companies, and we have all these complicated models that we make. But the part where behavioral science can help data science is actually in the last mile journey. Once you've made the model, how does it actually reach the consumer? And I'd written about this recently where the 2012 Obama campaign was actually famous for this. So they had a model, a data science model, which quite accurately predicted which way somebody was going to vote. Are they going to vote for or against, or are they undecided? But that's not enough information, right? After that, you still need to convince somebody to vote for you. And that's where the behavioral science part comes in. For example, for some people, the social norm might work. So telling people that 30% of people in your particular community are Democrats. So giving them a social norm would actually make some of these people on the edge move towards your side. So while the model does a great job of telling you what you should be showing or what this customer might prefer or which way they might go and doing a lot of predictions, what behavioral science can do is actually cover that last mile to actually use that information and present it in the right way. And the last part is around marketing. I think the catch here again is that marketing is always about insights. And while you'll have a lot of insights from what you've heard from people, we also most of the times don't know the real reason why and how someone would actually end up using your product. One of the most popular examples for this is actually the dishwasher, right? So in the UK, this is common knowledge that dishwashers exist not to clean dishes, but to hide your dirty dishes. So if you know that that's the real reason why people are buying your product, then how you're marketing to them will also be different. And when you know that, you can actually nudge users towards that product by using these understated reasons. For example, the how to make 2 months salary last forever. That's a classic example of knowing how people are actually thinking about your product and then using that to nudge a certain purchase. And the last part, I cannot do a speech on behavioral science without talking about the ethics of nudging, because that's very, very important. And especially for companies in the tech space, where it's very easy to do manipulation. It's very easy to nudge people towards the wrong direction. So, and we know this because we've seen headlines like this. This was a New York Times article about Uber that says Uber used psychological tricks to push its drivers' buttons. Nobody wants to be in that space. And how do you even know when a nudge starts becoming manipulative? So one of the things that we do internally, like this is something that I worked on with the design team as well, is having a simple framework that helps us answer this question. So we usually have these four questions. So the first one is, who's the primary beneficiary? So when you create a nudge, are you looking at companies and brands benefiting? So for example, when you're default opted into an insurance during a flight ticket purchase, you know it's not because you care for the customers, but it's because the companies are taking advantage of the fact that people will not opt out. The other end of that spectrum is a grocery store is encouraging healthy fruits, healthy eating with fruits and vegetables on visible shelves, despite lower margins. And they're doing that because they know that it's important for the society. So that's a nudge where you know that it's important to the society and you're keeping your own needs on the side. The second one is, does the beneficiary have a choice? So something like a default opt-in to subscriptions where getting out is very, very hard. Those are where it actually locks people in and it's reducing options. The other end of that is where choices are reversible and you're always highlighting the best option, but you're also showing the other options so that people can still take the other option if they want. The third one is the beneficiary feeling pressurized? I'm sure you would have seen this on hotel booking sites where it puts time and monetary pressure on people by saying 35 people are looking at this offer, offer expires in 10 minutes. Incidentally, a particular company was actually called out for this in the UK where for doing this, a case was put on them by the Competition Commission saying that by putting this information out, you are making people take a decision under pressure and that's not right. So it's not okay to do, just because you know that people are going to follow social norms doesn't mean that you should make them do that in the wrong way. The other extreme end of that is you're actually giving people behavioral freedom. So even if they made a choice, you give them the freedom to change their choice so that they don't feel like they've been pressured into doing this. And the last one and probably the most important one is, do people even want this outcome? If people are feeling abused when you told them about the nudge. So for example, one of the things that stands out in the Uber New York Times article is when drivers actually say that I lost 3 hours of sleep because I got back-to-back orders. That's actually drivers feeling bad that they've been nudged to take more orders. Although from the company's perspective, it makes sense because the drivers made more money. The drivers did not want that. So that's actually feeling bad about a nudge. The good part is when you tell somebody about a nudge and they actually feel happy about it. So for example, if somebody says, our arrangement ensured you picked healthy items in the grocery store, and people actually say, thank you, because that's what I want to always do, but I'm not able to do. So thank you that you changed the arrangement and helped me do that. So that's the other end of it. So if you answer these four questions, you would generally be in a position to know whether or not a nudge is worth doing and whether you're actually using it in the right way or the wrong way. So yeah, so that's the end of my presentation. I'll look at the questions in a bit. But yeah, this never exists, right? They all lived rationally ever after is behavioral science fiction. And that's why it's important to understand the irrational side of our brain and to keep that in mind when you're designing products or marketing or anything that's to do with consumers, just to remember that people are not always thinking logically the way you expect them to. And having this information would actually help you design products for the more real user and not for the rational, logical user who may or may not exist. So yeah, so that's all. And a very quick plug-in, shameless plug-in here. I also have a podcast. So if you have time and you're still interested in the subject after my rambling, please do listen to it.
Thank you, Priti. Thank you for sharing. Do you want to answer some of the questions?
Yeah, I'm just looking at that, yeah. There's a question here that says, does social proof have an altruistic element attached to it always? Can the concept stand without altruism? I'm not sure I understand the question there. Harshita says, is marriage a case of public commitment? Possibly. Growth.design, I agree completely, has amazing case studies on audits. So please do that. Oh, sorry, I just saw this, Carol, about... Okay, fine, let me get back to that. What statistically significant number of people to test on and how long is the test? That's actually very, very dependent on what you're doing. But generally, you would... there is a way to calculate your sample sizes. It should be pretty easy to find online. There are ways in which you can figure out your sample sizes. Generally, anything less than 500 does not make any sense at all. Anything around 1,000 is a good number to test on. Is there any course that you would recommend if I want to start learning about behavioral science? There are a bunch of them. From what I know, there's one by Rotman School, which is really good. Dilip Somans. I think it's there on edX, but I'm not sure of the exact name. Maybe if you could contact me separately on LinkedIn, I could send you the group. The 35 people booking this and offer expires in 10 minutes is common in travel sites. Does it become ethical if it has come to be accepted as an industry norm? Does the subjectivity of this evolve? That's a very good question. I think it doesn't matter how many people do it. The fact is that consumers are also smart. After a point of time, people start reacting. It's called psychological reactance. When you keep telling people, when you keep pushing people all the time, they will come to a point where they'll be like, I don't even want to make this purchase. And that has happened a lot of times in all of these sites. So I think the important thing is it doesn't become accepted because others are doing it. But even if others are doing it, if you look at it from your own perspective, if it is not necessary, you should try and avoid doing these nudges which can be construed as bad nudges and which might lead to some kind of psychological reactance which will actually backfire on you. So because others are doing it may or may not make it right, but and it may, maybe some people will accept it as an industry norm, but that still doesn't make it okay, because at some point consumers will get smart and they will react to it, and you don't want that.
Hey Priti, just follow up on that. So does that also depend on the way it's worded? Like, for example, if this said 35 people are looking at it, and you may not be able to confirm the booking or something, or you can pay later on this if you would like to confirm it sooner. If does that, yeah. or is the code that you're trying to pressurize somebody to buy?
Yeah, so that's what I was talking about when I said behavioral freedom. I'm still not saying that it's okay to pressurize them and then give them the freedom later. But the fact that you're giving them the autonomy to choose, like you're giving this information, but you're also adding in the same breath the fact that this is a decision that you're making because of this information, but that I'm also giving you the freedom to change this. I think overall, one of the things that I have learned in this product world for sure is about autonomy, because consumers are smart. So maybe you're right that maybe giving both information might actually be helpful. So if you can do that, then it's probably a better place to be in than just pressurizing people. Joydeep's question is, can it be concluded that human mind is mostly lazy by default? Actually, no, that's not true. It's not that we are lazy all the time, and it's not bad. It's just that you can't be using the rational side of your brain, although it's just not possible, right? For example, if you're just walking on the road, something is coming at you, you have to take a left or a right or move, right? You can't be sitting there and analyzing about what's the physics of this, what's the force with which it'll hit me. So actually what the brain is doing is not exactly being lazy. It's just giving you shortcuts and easy ways of doing things so that you don't have to think about all of these things all the time. So I think what you're actually getting from what actually you get from all of this system one, system two is the fact that your brain works in a certain way and it's evolved in this way because it's important for us. It's a very complex world and the way this is working is actually making this a little less complex for you. Somebody asked specifically about NPS. Maybe you could ask me on LinkedIn because that's a longer question. Somebody has put up the edX course. Please do have a look at it. Yeah, I think I've covered most. There are a couple I've skipped. If I've skipped, then please do reach out to me separately. I'd be happy to answer those.
Yep. Thank you, everyone, who joined us tonight. Thank you, Priti, for sharing so much insights on behavior science. And if anyone has more questions, please do reach out to Priti or her LinkedIn over there. I believe everyone joined today has learned so much from this session. So before we end the session tonight, could I ask everyone to open your video camera and we will take a screenshot of everyone who joined us. Please just open your cameras. Thank you. Okay, so a couple there. Can I get more? Can I have more? Let's see your pretty faces. Okay. Okay, yeah. I saw many people who opened up the cameras. Okay. Thank you. Okay. Get ready and smile. Let me take a group picture. Nice. Nice. Thank you, guys. Thank you, guys. So would you want to say special thanks to our donors who has make a donation to this session? Richard, Marina, Upasna, Aprajita, Mukar, Anamika, Ronan, Fred, Kaushal, Josh, Sandy, Sonali, Richard, Christine, thank you so much for your guys' support, helping the world to recover from recent tragedies. Okay. Thank you guys for joining us today. So that's the end of the sessions. If you guys have more questions, please feel free to reach out to Priti on LinkedIn. Thank you guys. Bye.